get benefited from this relationship. Monkeys are there on the trees, they have a strong eyesight. Deer are on the ground, they have a strong sense of a smell. Both these animals form the prey base for the tiger or for the or the leopard. So they have to basically blend their two senses to detect the presence of a tiger. So if there's a deer on the ground, there's a tiger coming from, you know, close by to kill the deer. The deer needs the help from monkey because, you know, deer is getting the signal smell of the tiger, but he wants to make sure as to which side the tiger is coming from. So he would give a warning call to the monkey. The monkey knows, oh, there's deer has given him the call, so there's something wrong. So the monkey will start scanning the area all around. And since he's right on the treetop, he has a better position to see the tiger. He would look at the tiger and then give the alarm call. The deer would look at the monkey's face, monkey looking that side, and deer knows to run this direction to save his life. What, I mean, how is monkey getting benefited from this relationship? That is also very interesting to know. If the tiger is hungry and he's not been able to catch any prey, he would come, he would hide himself, he would come under the tree where there's a troop of monkey on top. And under the tree, he would give a deep growl. Two or three would fall like potatoes right in front of him. Right? This is Nilgaya, blue bull. This is an antelope, which is just in North India, but not in Northeast India. And this is called, mongoose. This is marten, which is found in Namdafa in Arunachal and in Corbett. You see the jackal, the advantage of living in the group when they live in the packs. That's how the wild dogs are very successful predators. You know that? Porcupine, one of the reasons for a tiger to become man-eater is this. If a young tiger loses his temper, because porcupine forms a delicacy in the diet of tigers, if a young tiger loses his temper while killing a porcupine, the porcupine would stand their quills. The quills are very sharp and they get embedded into the bed, into the pad. And pad and the canine are the two main organs for a tiger to survive in the forest. If he's injured because of any of these two organs, he would not live like a normal tiger. He would either become a man-eater or cattle lifter or something. And he would always look for the easier prey to kill. Udbila, what you call, right? Common Indian otters. What you have in Assam is called a smooth Indian otter. It's a different species there. They're more blackish. What you have in Brahmaputra and in the Beals or the tributaries attached to Brahmaputra, that is called a smooth Indian otter. These are the common Indian otters, what you call them, Udbila. Interesting. Otters and crocodiles enjoy a very interesting relationship in the forest. Otters are amphibians. They live in the water, they live on land, and they're equally active in both the habitats, while crocodiles are active only in water, not active on land. Being reptiles, they're cold-blooded, so they have to maintain their body temperatures, and they have to come on the bank to do sunbathing, right? Now, otters form the delicacy in the diet of crocodiles, so crocodiles love eating them. They want to kill them in the water. But when the crocodiles are doing sunbathing on the ground, otters take their revenge out, they come from different directions and they start pinching the crocodile from here and there. And the poor guy had to save his life by slipping back into water. It's an interesting relationship. Asiatic elephants. Now in the world we have three species of elephants, you know that? Earlier there were two, people used to say, African and Asiatic. Now African elephants are divided into two, African savanna, African forest, and Asiatic elephants. If you go by the size, African savanna elephant is about, a male would be something around 5,000 kgs. African forest, the male would be something around 4,500 kgs. Asiatic elephant would be something around 4,000 kgs. The biggest Asiatic elephant would be about 4,000 kgs. Whether it's a population in Northeast India or Southern India or Northwest India. You know, there are no elephants in Central India. Can you see this black marking here? Right. Something very interesting, I love watching them, and this is one of the most social animals I've ever seen in my life, and I would always give full marks to elephant than a tiger, though tiger was the subject of my studies. Can you see this black marking here, right? This is called musth elephant. Have you heard of this word called musth? When the breeding season comes, like all other herbivores, elephants have to fight, males have to fight among themselves for the harem. You know harem formation? A group of females led by a single dominant male. During the harem formation, males have to fight among themselves, and the fighting organ is always the tusk and the trunk. There are several males who have the urge to be with the females, but they have they've lost the battle to the dominant males. In these males, the temporal glands here burst. And when they burst, they start secreting an oil. And this oil is known as must, M-U-S-T-H, must. Now, we have been very commonly using this word in Hindi, gola must, daru pike must, hati must, right? But the word must comes from the glands. The secretion is known as must. Also, there's an interesting behavior among the elephants, and I was trying to tell people last evening, the National Geographic Channel. There's a thing called aunting behavior, you know? My father's sister is my auntie, my mother's sister is my auntie, right? There's aunting behavior in the case of elephants, which is very, very prominent. Elephants have a long gestation period. Gestation period is about 22 months. The calf which is born to a mother is pretty heavy. At times, during the process of parturition, when the birth is taking place, mothers die because of excessive bleeding and all that. Now, looking at the process of parturition, females of the same age class as the mother would start lactating. So that if the mother dies, the calf can be looked after. Because it's a key, you know, S-selected and K-selected species? You must have?
Yes.
So elephant is a K-selected species. So with the long gestation period, they do not want to lose the calf. So the mothers start the aunties, they call aunties, right? Aunties of the same age class as the mother, they would start lactating. So if the calf is born, if the mother dies, the calf can be looked after by the aunties. That's how, you know, you must have seen, have you seen the wild herds of elephants? No.
Yes.
The calf is somewhere in the middle. You don't even see him. There are females all around. And then, you know, this is the jungle cat. At one point of time, we had 16 species of cats in India. Now only 15 are left because cheetahs have gone extinct. We've got tiger, leopard, clouded leopard, snow leopard, and lion. The five big cats. Jungle cat, fishing cat, leopard cat, desert cat, marble cat, Pallas's cat, rusty spotted cat, lynx, caracal. These are the lesser cats. This is a jungle cat. Panthers and cats and leopards are different. You know, people say that panthers and leopards. Panthers are a group of cats with short tails and pointed ears. Panthers are not great climbers of the trees, while leopards are great climbers. Leopards have long prehensile tail which balances the weight of the body, right, when they're climbing. And panther and leopards also have roundish ears. So in India, we have panthers like lynx is a panther, caracal is a panther, rusty spotted cat is a panther, jaguar is a panther, puma is a panther. Have you heard of these names?
No.
Jaguar and puma? Is it all making sense what I'm
yes,
telling
sir.
You? Is it interesting?
Yes, sir.
This is a leopard after the feast. He had a good meal and you can see heavy belly and it's relaxing. The size difference between tiger and leopard is about 4-4.5 times. The tiger weighs about 250 kgs, while the leopard the biggest leopard would weigh about 60 kgs. Tiger would make his kill on the ground, would feed on the ground. Leopard would make his kill on the ground, would always try to take it on the trees to avoid competition from hyenas, from wolves, from jackals, from tigers themselves. A tiger on an average has to make about 20 attempts to make a kill, while a leopard has to make only 10 because he has the advantage of climbing the trees and then leaping on his prey from the trees. If a tiger becomes a man-eater, he would still avoid human beings because tigers cannot live with human beings, while leopards love to live near human habitations. They relish dogs, cats, poultry, livestock besides their natural prey. So based on all these observations, we consider leopards as better hunters in the forests or more successful hunters in the forest than the tigers. This is one of my study animals. I studied this tiger for a number of years. And the tigers have got long canines. This is actually a cub. When I caught him first, it was a cub. This is about 3-year-old cub. And then the different postures of tigers. If you have any query, we can always interact on the mail and all that because you're getting late for the safari. I don't want you to miss your time in the forest. Live tiger sighting is just one of the ways of seeing a tiger. There are 9 ways of seeing a tiger, especially when you're going into the natural habitat of the tiger, where the tigers are roaming free and wide. They're not caged, they're not in enclosure. The tiger sighting is guaranteed in a safari park and in a zoo, but not in the national park. But there are a number of ways of seeing a tiger in the forest. Number one is the live tiger sighting, when a tiger crosses the road in front of you, when a tiger walks along the jeeps, or when he's sitting on the water hole or sitting in the bush and your guide spots it for you. But otherwise, when a tiger walks on the forest roads, he leaves his pug marks on the forest roads. When he marks his territory, he scratches his claws on the tree trunk, and this is called claw marking. And then they also spray their urine on the vegetation like this, which is a very prominent smell. I can smell a tiger urine from a distance. It's a very prominent smell. And then tiger fecal droppings, you know, you see the dropping, fecal droppings, and you can see the porcupine quills in these. Can you see the porcupine quills in these droppings? Yes. And then a tiger sits on the forest road, you can see the buttock marks and the tail mark, that's called tiger bat. And then when a tiger is on the move, the monkeys would give the alarm call, the deer would give the alarm call, the tiger would roar, the tiger would growl, the tiger would make a kill, so you'll kill, see the kill of the tiger. The tiger also dies because of natural process or because of territorial fights. So these are the 9 ways of seeing a tiger. And this one is looking back at us. If he can do something to save him. Lovely. I will finish it off here. And